What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of this series, we designed a tiny URL-like system and detailed how to best answer system design interview questions. Today, we are going to cover another example of system design questions, and that example is WhatsApp. So, we lay out one possible design of a WhatsApp-like system. Now, before diving deeper into the subject, let's understand, how does communication work? You see, when two clients A and B want to communicate or send messages to each other, they first know the address of one another. It may be IP, MAC, or any customized unique identity, and they exchange messages with each other over a network, in this case, the internet. But what if the network is very large and the number of clients is in the millions or billions? Well, in this case, it will become very difficult for each client to know the address of every other client, which forces us to introduce the concept of a server. The task of this server is to coordinate between all the clients connected to it. Now, all clients, instead of making a connection with each other, make a connection with the server. In this example, when client A wants to send a message to client B, it first sends the message to the server, and the server knows the address of all clients, B included, then it forwards the message to that client, and vice versa. That is a common representation of the communication architecture. Let's design one for WhatsApp specifically. And before designing any product, it is important to know the functional and non-functional requirements of that product. In this case, let's say that our system should support one-on-one chat and group chats. It should support file sharing like images and videos, etc. It should allow us to see a sent, delivered, and read receipts of the messages, should show the last seen time of the users, and should send push notifications. Additionally, the system should also be highly available with minimal latency, scalable, and efficient. Let's start designing the application based on the requirements we just listed, and let's kick this off with the estimations and constraints. So, let us assume we have 50 million daily active users, and on average, each user sends at least 10 messages to 4 different people every day. This gives us 2 billion messages per day. Messages can also contain media such as images, videos, or other files. We can assume that 5% of messages are media files shared by the users, which gives us an additional 100 million files we would need to store. Consequently, we can say that 2 billion requests per day translate into 24k requests per second. Now, if we assume each message on average is 100 bytes, we will require about 200 gigabytes of database storage every day. As per our requirements, we also know that around 5% of our daily messages are media files. If we assume each file is 100 kilobytes on average, we will require 10 terabytes of storage every day. And for 10 years, we will require about 38 petabytes of storage. As our system is handling 10 terabytes every day, we will require a minimum bandwidth of around 120 megabytes per second. Small reminder here, as we previously mentioned, make sure to check any scale or traffic-related assumptions with the interviewer. Let's go ahead now and lay out the possible tables we may use for this design. The users table will contain a user's information such as name, phone number, and other details. The messages table will contain messages with properties such as type, text, image, video, etc., content, and timestamps for message delivery. The message should potentially have a corresponding chat ID or group ID. The chats table basically represents a private chat between two users and can contain multiple messages, and the groups table represents a group made up of multiple users and their messages. Now that we have our models, we should find out what kind of database we should use. While our data model seems quite relational, we don't necessarily need to store everything in a single database, as this can limit our scalability and quickly become a bottleneck. We could split the data between different services, each having ownership over a particular table. Then we can use a relational database such as PostgreSQL or a distributed NoSQL database such as Apache Cassandra for our use case. Next is the API design. Some potential APIs that our service will need to expose to provide the requested functionalities are: the getAll call will return all chats or groups for the given user ID, the getMessages will return all the messages corresponding to a given chat or group ID, the sendMessages will send a message from a user to a chat or group, and the join group or leave group allows a user to join or leave a group. Now, let's do a high-level design of our system. We will be using a microservices architecture since it will make it easier to horizontally scale and decouple our services. Each service will have ownership of its own data model. Let's try to divide our system into some core services. The user service, this is an HTTP-based service that handles user-related concerns such as authentication and user information. The chat service will use WebSockets and establish connections with the client to handle chat and group message related functionality. We can also use a cache to keep track of all the active connections to determine if the user is online or not. The notification service, this service will simply send push notifications to the users. The presence service, this service will keep track of the last seen status of all users. And the media service, this service will handle media such as images, videos, and file uploads. How do we efficiently send and receive messages? We have two different options, the pull and push models. In the pull model, the client periodically sends an HTTP request to servers to check if there are any new messages. In the push model, the client opens a long-lived connection with the server, and once new data is available, it will be pushed to the client. We can use WebSockets or server-sent events or SSE for this. In this example, the pull model approach is not scalable as it will create unnecessary request overhead on our servers, and most of the time the response will be empty, thus wasting our resources. To minimize latency, using the push model with WebSockets is a better choice, because then we can push data to the client once it's available without any delay, given that the connection is open with the client. Also, WebSockets provide bidirectional communication, unlike server-sent events which are only unidirectional. Now, concerning the last seen functionality, we can use a heartbeat mechanism, where the client can periodically ping the servers, indicating their liveliness. This will give us the last time the user was active and will be handled by the presence service. Concerning notifications, once a message is sent in a chat or group, we will first check if the recipient is active or not. We can get this information by taking the user's active connection and last seen into consideration. If the recipient is not active, the chat service will add an event to a message queue. The notification service will then consume the event from the message queue and forward the request to Firebase Cloud Messaging or Apple Push Notification Service based on the client's device platform. Okay, handling read receipts can be tricky. For this use case, we can wait for some sort of acknowledgement from the client to determine if the message was delivered and update the corresponding delivered at field. Similarly, we will mark the message as seen once the user opens the chat and updates the corresponding seen at timestamp field. Now that we have identified some core components, let's do the first draft of our system design. Note that in messaging applications, we must keep in mind using caches as necessary because our users will mostly expect the latest data. Additionally, some group chats can have thousands of messages, and sending this much data over the network would be inefficient. To improve this, we can add pagination to our system APIs. This way, users won't have to retrieve all messages unless requested. Since we will be using multiple protocols like HTTP, WebSocket, and TCP/IP, deploying multiple load balancers separately for each protocol will be expensive. Instead, we can use an API gateway that supports multiple protocols without any issues. API gateway can also offer other features such as authentication, authorization, rate limiting, throttling, and API versioning, which will improve the quality of our services. Let's go ahead now and identify bottlenecks and attempt to resolve them, such as single points of failure in our design. So, we can ask ourselves, what if one of our services crashes? How to improve the availability of our cache? Wouldn't API gateway be a single point of failure? How can we make our notification system more robust? How can we reduce media storage costs? Does chat service have too much responsibility? To make our system more resilient, we can run multiple instances of each of our services, or horizontally scale the most loaded services of the system. We can introduce load balancers between clients, servers, databases, and cache servers. We can use multiple read replicas for our databases and multiple instances and replicas for our distributed cache. We can also have a standby replica of our API gateway, etc. Again, you don't have to dive into the details at this point during an interview. Just quickly highlighting these ideas will be enough. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.